believe, I have like a belief in like an objective truth of that there is something that sounds great, you know, good sounding audio, there's an objective truth to that. And I believe that that objective truth exists outside of my mind. It exists outside of me. And really, the music knows what it needs. What I try to do is try to evolve my technique to the point where I can just listen to the instructions and translate on behalf of the song. The idea that the song has an opinion, it has an objective part of it that can be better, and I think through mixing and definitely and mastering, it's about fulfilling what the song wants and what the song needs, you know, versus, you know, my opinion or sometimes even the artist's opinion, you know.
For me, the most important tool in the toolbox is the equalization. Here at Cosmic Zoo on the desk, we have four stereo lanes of EQ, starting here with the API 550As to the Electrodyne 511s to the Elijah X-Filter 500 to the Avitas E27s. Each one of these EQs has special functions to them that they're good at. I really like the 550A and how that's able to really push certain mid-range frequencies easily. The 511 is a very nice, broad EQ. It just sounds great on drums. Popular from the Motown console they use in Detroit, same EQs. The Elijah's a little more futuristic. It's a very clean EQ, but also very warm. And then the Avitas, I mean, these are arguably some of the best made EQs ever. I use these in mastering as well. It has a few unique things, but most importantly, it allows you to boost at 28 kilohertz, which is something no plugin can do. I feel like EQ is the most important part of mixing. I mean, volume is very important as well, but insofar as where you're really doing the most manipulation, I want to say most of it should be happening with the EQs. Sometimes I'll be compressing something or, you know, using dynamics on a sound, when in actuality the solution should be an EQ thing. And I constantly remind myself of that to, you know, come back to EQ as the fundamental solution. It is, in my opinion, the most important part of the process. The way we use this board with the buses, each channel is able to be assigned to one of four buses, A, B, C, and D. With the SSL, one of the advantages of using a board like this is you can get saturation from driving the channels. You can do the same thing on the buses. So it comes to this section over here, and you can basically get two layers of SSL goodness with this console. And so here are the individual channels right here. We're able to bring up on this board 24 channels total, but it really, with this console, with these faders, it's different than a digital fader. A digital fader, you turn it up, it's just gonna get louder. On this, of course, it does get louder, but it also will saturate. It will create a harmonic that usually is very pleasing. My position on the loudness wars changes. I've gone back and forth with different viewpoints of, should it be super dynamic? Should it be super compressed? I think the answer is somewhere in the middle. But if you study engineering and you study mastering, it should occur to you very quickly that there's trends. Trends in mastering range eras for how it was in the 80s to the 90s to the 2000s to today. Without a doubt, it's gotten louder and louder and louder. But it just comes down to me, sounding modern to a certain degree. And if you print a record that's super dynamic, it's just not gonna sound like today. And I've had to come to that realization over and over again.